Bun, 3, 2, 1 și da?
Da.
Hello everyone, thank you very much for joining this event. I have here with me Daniela, who is a software developer and an experienced interviewer. And today we'll have this kind of an experiment where I'll sit on the interviewee chair and she will interview me. And what you have to learn from this event is both how the interviewer asks the questions and the reasons the reasons they choose specific kind of questions and how should an interviewer act during the interview and also how should the interviewee answer and how should they act in case they know and also in case they don't know how to tackle a specific question. So that's what we are going today to share with you, and I hope you like the event. Don't forget that you can ask questions during the live session in the chat, and you can also ask questions afterwards in the comment section. And of course, as usual, you can find me on LinkedIn and Twitter, and we can discuss there. So I think we should start now. Daniela, can you tell us what is the scenario for this interview?
Yeah, sure. First of all, thank you very much for this invitation. It's really nice to be here with you guys tonight. And the scenario would be the following. So the role Laurencio applied for is for a senior engineer with skills to be a team lead, very knowledgeable about the agile processes, and able to start projects from scratch and build a team. So I will focus my my questions on this direction. So his answer should be relevant for this scenario, because you know it depends very much on the role the interview is for. So I can ask a huge variety of questions, but I will focus on the ones relevant for this role.
So it's different if have an interview with a junior level rather than having with a senior, and you always know before which are the technologies you are looking for, mm-hmm. what is the specific kind of guy or girl or folk you are looking for.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like the profile.
The profile.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So we will focus in this case on a senior position, mm-hmm. with leadership skills and specifically with Spring technologies.
Mm-hmm.
Okay,
yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
So let's start.
Ready to go?
I'm ready.
Okay. Good luck. So, hi Laurencio. Thank you for being here today. So, let's start this interview with a discussion about your past experience, like your background in what kind of projects you worked on before, what was your role, what kind of tasks you had.
Okay, so I have quite some experience. I'm working for more than 10 years already in software development. Mm-hmm. And of course I've started as a software developer, but in the past projects I've been working as a consultant as well as a development lead. I've been mostly working with Java technologies related to Spring, mm-hmm. but in the past I also had projects with specific Java Enterprise Edition mm-hmm. technologies. The most recent ones are specifically oriented around software-oriented architecture, mm-hmm. kind of architectural style. Mm-hmm. But I also had the chance to work on monolithic applications.
Mm-hmm. That's
usually
really nice because I think that gave you the opportunity to put them in balance and to assess the advantages disadvantages for each of them. So
especially because most of the monolithic applications I've been working with were old, and that mm-hmm. usually means messy code. Mm-hmm. And that somehow forced me into finding out how it's easier to find which are the root causes of specific problems,
mm-hmm.
Which in case of an application with lack of class design is rather more difficult.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I imagine that this monolithic application also taught you how to approach a problem, how to investigate it, how to implement clean solution as much as it was possible, of course.
Both architecturally as well as at the lower level design, yes, I would say. So it taught me how important it is to modularize your application in case you have a monolithic application. When should you have a monolithic application? When should you drive to a service-oriented architecture?
Mm-hmm.
And of course, now most of the systems, and in the past 4 to 5 years at least, the systems I've been working with were generally service-oriented.
Mm-hmm.
I wouldn't necessarily say microservices, because you know there is a lot of misunderstanding around what microservices are out there. So usually people tend to refer to any kind of Spring Boot application with some REST endpoints as being a microservice, which
mm-hmm.
is not necessarily the case. So contrary
mm-hmm.
to the popular opinion.
But why? Why is not the case? Could you please explain?
It's a lot more than having just a service which is small, to call it a microservice.
Mm-hmm.
So I think in most cases that micro in microservices is driving a lot of confusion, because people tend to believe that if you have a small service, then and that's
enough.
Communicating,
that's
enough, and it's communicating
mm-hmm.
with some other services around, that's enough. But it's a lot more in that architectural style. First of all, not only in decomposing the business logic in
mm-hmm.
multiple services that can run on multiple machines, is also the persistent persistence layer. So you have to,
how should it be,
you have to decompose it as well. So you have to each service that needs a persistence layer to have its own and manage its own persistent and database behind the scenes.
Mm-hmm.
And that allows a great flexibility, like the fact that not only at the business layer you can be polyglottic, meaning you can have
mm-hmm.
multiple services with different technologies implemented, but you can have multiple technologies now at the persistence layers as well,
mm-hmm.
which means one microservice may have a relational database, because that's what the case needs, that
mm-hmm.
was what the use case needs there. Another microservice might use a NoSQL database such as MongoDB, because
mm-hmm.
again, that's what's best for that service.
Mm-hmm.
It's a lot to discuss around the transactionability, how
mm-hmm.
to take into consideration the data consistency when you have microservices, because of that, how to, even from the architectural point of view, how to guess what is the right amount of business logic you should put in a service, because micro, it doesn't necessarily mean you have 1,000 lines of codes and you have
mm-hmm.
this kind of limit, and then if you are over it, it's not a
mm-hmm.
microservice anymore. No, it's a lot more than that, and this kind of decision, what exactly needs to be put in a service so that it takes the best out of the availability further. And when you want to run it on multiple availability
mm-hmm.
zones in cloud, for example, that's what makes
mm-hmm.
microservices difficult. And in my opinion, there are just a few really projects that comply with all these aspects in the real world.
Mm-hmm.
In most cases, and in the cases, for example, I've been working with, I said I don't necessarily call them microservices, even though companies, enterprises where I've been working with, they call them microservices.
Mm-hmm. They are marketed.
They are well marketed, but they are not necessarily microservices in terms of what this architectural style should be. They are more just service-oriented
mm-hmm.
architectures.
Mm-hmm. You said something about being able to isolate the business, like one business component in one microservice, like isolate the logic related to that. Have you had the scenario in which multiple microservices were using the same logic, like a chunk of logic which was needed in multiple microservices?
So you ask me if in those services the code was replicated, or have we used some kind of a library?
Yeah.
Well, again,
how you handle that situation?
This depends, as everything else in software. In some cases, we usually say code application should never happen, but in my opinion, or at least in my experience, it's not necessarily that the case. So in some situations, duplicating code spares you some complexity from the deployment point of view. So you might want,
mm-hmm.
for example, to duplicate some model classes
mm-hmm.
Instead of, say, putting them into a given library.
Mm-hmm.
In many cases, you might find out they don't necessarily need to be anyway exactly the same.
Mm-hmm.
Because I'm telling you, I will tell you an example now. So we say we have two services using a JPA implementation such as Hibernate, which happens pretty often in the in today's projects. You have a specific entity, and that entity have of course its own fields. It might be that a service works with all of the fields and another service only needs a couple of the fields. And in that case, you might of course want to say put the same class into a library and drag it into the both projects. Or you might want to replicate the code, and in this specific situation, replicating the code might be a better idea, because one service, even if you would say, if I put all this, those fields there into the entity, it will not necessarily affect anything. It might, but not necessarily. But you might better focus exactly on what that service uses, and you and declare only those couple of fields that are really used by that service in that entity. And that, for example, helps in maintainability, because when a developer will see that entity, will know that it's not 20 fields that service works with, it's only a couple of them.
But what would be the risk of this approach of having duplicated code?
Definitely having duplicated code could mean that if you change it in one side, if you have, for example, I said entities in the previous example, but now let's shift a bit and say we are discussing about DTOs, about data transfer objects. In case of data transfer objects, you might get into a situation where a developer changes something in one of the, the parts of the communication in one of the services and doesn't change it appropriately in the other one. And in that case, the communication might be broken. And I know theoretically you have integration tests, but practically we know that it's not always the case.
And so still, you lose some time.
Yes.
Until the integration test is run, you see that it fails, someone has to pick up the task of fixing it. So,
So there are, there are, again, approaches which it really, you really need to know where you are, which is the system, to say which is the best solution. But in my opinion, both of them are appropriate depending on where you use them.
Okay. Still related to the architectural approaches, what kind of communication method have you used between various microservices that form a system?
So in most cases, I've been using RESTful endpoints. Which of course we call them RESTful endpoints. We know that in real world they are not necessarily RESTful, all of them, but it stays the same technically. We have some endpoints.
Pretty flexible.
Yeah, exactly. Theoretically we should comply to some specifications, but it's not always the case. But let's call them RESTful services. And in some cases, some messaging approach, of course, was the right choice, like JMS or Kafka.
Have you used any of these tools?
So I've used them in a few systems that I've been implemented, but I could say that it was more rare than using RESTful endpoints. And that's mostly because of the fact that RESTful endpoints are very simple, usually simple to implement, and they really apply in a lot of cases pretty well. SOAP, which is a very old technology, SOAP web services, I've been using them as well, but I would say longer in the past. Like, I can't recall when was the last time I touched a SOAP web service. So it was more than 6-7 years ago.
Okay. Could you give me an example of, let's say, an advantage of using Kafka or JMS over the RESTful APIs, or in which type of application you would choose to use Kafka or JMS?
First of all, RESTful endpoints, as well as SOAP web services, as well as RMI, if we are going very, very much into the past, they are called RPC communication methods, so remote procedure calls. And that makes them synchronized. So whenever a client calls something on the server side, it has to wait for for a response, and that mm-hmm. applies even in the case where you mark a method as being asynchronous on the server side, because from the protocol point of view, it's only the fact that the response comes faster, like immediately after the request, is just because the call, the action was taken by a different thread on the server side. So even in case of asynchronous methods, it's still synchronous theoretically from the protocol point of view. So that means when you have a call and you call a specific method on the server side, the client waits until it gets a response. So in many cases, that's a good thing, but mm-hmm. It also has its own pitfalls. Like what happens, for example, if you have multiple chain of calls between multiple services mm-hmm. and one of them fails. Mm-hmm. That's a common thing that happens in microservices and service-oriented architectures.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, sorry.
If I may, we have a very good question in the chat. So it relates to our current discussion. Could you please describe microservices patterns that are needed to know? And I think one pattern applies exactly to the scenario
maybe the most important one of the most important patterns that you need to know is what you do when you have distributed transactions, which is again mm-hmm. related to what we were discussing now.
Mm-hmm.
So this is, for example, Saga pattern that is one of the methods we use to implement a way to make sure that if something fails in a service and the other service managed to complete successfully its mm-hmm. action, you don't fail the entire use case, because when you have a mm-hmm. use case in a service-oriented architecture, it might be that it's completed by different services
mm-hmm.
and
mm-hmm.
when you have only one service, it's fine, because usually if something happens, the app throws an exception, you have one transaction, it gets rolled back.
And you don't have any other dependencies.
Mm-hmm. But if you have multiple services, then the problem is that one of them might fail and then the other one succeeded already into committing the data, into mm-hmm. persisting them into their database, because if you have microservices, as I said earlier, you have mm-hmm. different persistent layers.
And how could you mitigate?
So you have two options, the distributed transactions and the Saga patterns,
mm-hmm.
which in my perspective, none of them is easy to implement. The distributed transactions are easier to implement, and it simply means that you don't commit the transaction until all of the service is finished. When all of the services successfully finished, they notify, say, a centralized manager, which can be even one of the services,
mm-hmm.
And then all of them commit all together. The problem with this is that it can happen that the commit fails as well. So it's not necessarily mm-hmm. that if you have this kind of two-step commit, the first commit works, and it's not necessarily that the second one cannot fail. So that's a problem with distributed transactions. So a different approach is let them commit completely and use a Saga. And what a Saga is a composition of steps. It's like a story with chapters.
Okay.
You have multiple chapters. If one of them fails, you notify all the other services to roll back. But in this case, rolling back is more difficult, because it's not like rolling back a transaction. The transaction already committed. It's applying the reverse scenario to make the
mm-hmm.
data again as it was before.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, Saga pattern has, first of all, the problem that is really complex. So it's
mm-hmm.
difficult. The more services you have, the more difficult
it
is to implement. So
actually,
complexity,
mm-hmm.
which means it takes a lot of time for the developers to implement it. So you really have to think about, do we need this? Do we need to implement this or not? Because you already
mm-hmm.
know from the beginning that it will be difficult to test, difficult
mm-hmm.
to implement. It will take a lot of time. So
mm-hmm.
that's the compromise you have to make. And it's also the fact that what should you do if the rollback actions fail? Because it can happen that in the Saga, then everything
mm-hmm.
Is fine, but then the rollback fails. So
mm-hmm.
it's still Okay. There are problems on both sides. Mm-hmm. But I would recommend, in case of patterns in general, how to use the communication between services, how to commit and persist the data, distribute the transactions and so on.
Mm-hmm.
The best, say, book containing all of this is Chris Richardson, Microservices Patterns.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a book that when I have a doubt on something I implement, I do go to the specific chapter in that book and read it again.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay, cool. What about other enterprise patterns?
In case of... Let's say,
have you implemented an API gateway?
Okay, an API gateway. I was actually thinking before you asked me on retries on
mm-hmm.
RESTful services, because that's one of the very often encountered. And I was also thinking about the circuit breaker,
mm-hmm.
because that's something we also encounter often. But an API gateway, yes, that's one of the points that I would say. I'm not even sure if I've seen a system without having an API gateway.
Mm-hmm. What is the role of an API gateway?
You have clients, shortly, it's
mm-hmm.
to make the server-side implementation, the server-side architecture transparent for a client.
Mm-hmm.
And secondly, to help securing well from a very first point what goes to the services that implements the business logic behind the scenes.
Mm-hmm.
So these two main purposes are the most important in a gateway. First of all, when a client communicates with your backend, the client doesn't need to know you have multiple services behind the scenes. It's your duty there. So they only see the gateway. It's like
mm-hmm.
the name suggests, it's a gateway. Yep. It's just the way the requests go through. And then because it's a gate, there is one thing is where you can apply security at the first
mm-hmm.
Point. And secondly, of course, you can even audit the requests.
Mm-hmm. Another question is in the chat. Can you explain the most complex design pattern?
The most complex?
I will
skip fast over this question, because I think the most complex microservices design pattern,
yeah,
I guess that,
yeah,
that's
yeah,
what everything
yeah.
about
yeah.
is the saga pattern. So I
so
can't
already...
see one more complex than that in my perspective. As I said also earlier,
mm-hmm.
you need to think carefully when you want to apply something like that, because you already know from the beginning it will be difficult to implement and difficult to test.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay. I was still searching a bit in the chat, because there are really, really good questions.
And a lot of people watching us already.
Yeah. In short, if you can answer, how do you handle authentication and authorization when communicating between microservices?
Wow, that's a really good question.
Yeah.
But of course, we can discuss. I think we can discuss more than a week only about this.
Mm-hmm.
My favorite is when you don't have to implement it at all. So
mm-hmm.
that's my favorite. Of course, it doesn't usually mm-hmm. always apply, so you can't
yeah.
always leave everything unsecured. But what I want to mean with that is that you always need to take into consideration the possibility of taking that out, because you don't. It's a compromise between performance, maintainability, security, that software architecture in general. So
mm-hmm.
you have to always take into consideration that. Then you have the possibility to apply this at the application level. That means you have your applications implemented. You have a lot of ways here in which one application can authenticate another when making a request, when sending a request. You can use certificates, you can use a simple static key,
mm-hmm.
You can use a signed token, you can simply sign the data when it's transferred with a secret. So that's another possibility. So you have a lot of ways to implement this at the application level.
Mm-hmm.
And I would say that implementing it at the application level is a lower level implementation of the security. Nowadays, in microservices, an approach that I like more than implementing the security at the application level is using a service mesh such as Istio.
Mm-hmm.
So what a service mesh is, As the name suggests, it's a mesh which covers the microservices delivered, say, in a Kubernetes in a Kubernetes environment, and it intercepts. It uses this notion of what's called a sidecar container, which is a container deployed near the application container inside the same pod, and that container is intercepting the requests and the response, and there you can apply different kind of logic for auditing, for security, and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what I think is the future for, especially for microservices architectures.
Mm-hmm. If we think about the CI/CD, like continuous integration, continuous deployment, have you been involved in this side of development?
Sure, I could say that I implemented at some point, even from zero, from scratch, continuous delivery integration and delivery pipeline. I did that with Jenkins in the past,
mm-hmm.
And mostly using Git as a subversioning system. Okay. I used SVN, but very long time in the past, so I can't say I've worked a lot with SVN,
okay.
but Git is
okay.
Anyway
Git.
The future,
yeah,
so
yeah.
we don't care about SVN.
Mm-hmm.
For Jenkins, the approach of implementing the CI/CD was with a simple Groovy script. Jenkins has two ways of implementing the UI way, where you have the steps, you implement the pipeline,
mm-hmm.
and you write whatever commands and stuff like that Jenkins should do for each and every step. Or you have the programmatic approach, where you can use a Groovy script. And the programmatic approach should be always the choice, because being that you write a script, you can subversion it, so
mm-hmm.
you can work
yeah.
over it as same as you work over your application. In the past two or three projects, I worked with GitLab.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, in case of GitLab, same as we have now also in GitHub, you have the actions. You can programmatically also define them. The only thing that I dislike about that is the YAML language. I don't
mm-hmm.
really, I'm not a fan of YAML, but you have to use it. You don't,
yeah.
don't have a lot of choices. So in Kubernetes today, when configuring the components, in several other kinds of technologies used on the CI/CD, you
mm-hmm.
need to use YAML, so you have to get used to with that, especially with tabs and spaces. That's the
yeah,
problem.
Yeah, it's a pain. Yeah. What about orchestration of microservices? Have you used any tools? Have you been involved in this?
Yes, my favorite being, of course, Kubernetes. So I've been
mm-hmm.
using Kubernetes from the very beginning of Kubernetes, I would say.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't use Kubernetes as the first tool. I use something that's developed over Kubernetes, which is called OpenShift.
Mm-hmm.
OpenShift is a platform as a service having Kubernetes
yeah,
behind
yeah.
the scenes. So you write your components same as for Kubernetes, and they are run by OpenShift. The idea is that when you have microservices, to easily deploy them, you need containers, because you need a way to easily spin them up. Restarting them and so on and so forth. And
if we think of quality attributes in software, could you name a few quality attributes that let's say could be implemented or are handled by orchestration tools?
Sure, probably the most important being availability.
Mm-hmm.
So one of the things you do with an orchestration tool is, yeah, first of all, you need it to make automatic the process of spinning up and down containers,
mm-hmm.
restarting them and so on. But one in terms of non-functional requirements of software qualities, availability is probably the most affected. That is, you can easily program Kubernetes to restart your
mm-hmm.
Container when that's needed. And if the service is small, then the container is small, and then the time to restart the service will be small as well.
Mm-hmm.
There were those times when you had to wake up at 3 a.m. and restart your service manually, pressing a button, yeah, logging in somewhere and pressing a button. Someone
yeah.
had to stay on call for that.
Mm-hmm.
That's no longer the case, because now if you implement correctly your architecture, you have the healthiness and the readiness endpoints. mm-hmm. and Kubernetes checks them. If something goes wrong with the help with the readiness endpoint, it automatically decouples it from the load balancer and it restarts the container.
Mm-hmm.
Also, from the availability point of view, that is affected by this is the horizontally auto scaling, because you can implement Kubernetes to scale up and down the number of containers and of course the number of pods. And of course,
mm-hmm.
We just had Black Friday some days ago.
Mm-hmm.
We all know what happens during Black Friday. A lot of
mm-hmm.
people go into this kind of online shops and they suddenly have a lot more requests. And then
mm-hmm.
if you automatically make sure you have a cloud deployed application, you can automatically make sure when something like this happens, it goes up. And then it automatically goes down, horizontally scaling,
mm-hmm.
and in this case, horizontally auto-scaling, because
mm-hmm.
you program
mm-hmm.
your application to do that for you.
Mm-hmm. Okay, cool. Thank you. If you're thinking about testing your application, have you been involved in, writing tests or making a decision what kind of tests should be written in your project or what kind of testing tools to be used?
Sure. Both making a decision as well as writing tests.
Okay.
Because you start from writing tests and you have
mm-hmm.
to do this whatever implementation you write.
Mm-hmm.
But there are a lot of things to understand here as well. First of all is we have different kind of tests. We have unit tests, we have
mm-hmm.
integration tests, we have system tests in the end.
Mm-hmm.
The testing can be done automatically or can be done manually.
Mm-hmm.
That's from the management point of view.
Mm-hmm.
You have to choose what you need for the project. And
mm-hmm.
if we go to an administrative point of view, but I will be very fast with this, you always have a budget, so you always have to choose
yeah,
the right people.
You
might end up not having testers at all.
Yeah, this
you
is
might
always
end up,
a constraint.
Always a constraint. But say we just resume to the development point of view,
mm-hmm.
and we
don't
discuss about testing by a different team in this case. You can have security testing, have a lot of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
But in terms of being a developer, you usually have to implement unit tests and
mm-hmm.
integration tests.
Mm-hmm.
And these again are really important because depending on how you implement them, you might make your application less maintainable
mm-hmm.
than which is basically the contrary of what tests should be.
Mm-hmm.
And at the same time, you can't stay without tests, because if you don't have a tested application, whenever the application grows and
mm-hmm.
more and more you forget what you've implemented. People come and go, so the team changes throughout
mm-hmm.
time. And if you don't have tests, then when it will happen at some point that whenever you change something, you will not be sure of whatever else you have affected.
Mm-hmm.
You will always be frightened by, should I change this line or not, because I might affect something
mm-hmm.
else, which is called the butterfly effect.
Yeah. You know, this role also assumes that you will be able to gather a team and start a project. I would be interesting to know if you have some knowledge on the automation tools for testing, both functional and non-functional. And I'm asking this because maybe you would be required to assist the QA members of your team, like to get the project started.
I would say not much. I worked in the past with Appium for
mm-hmm.
mobile development practices.
Mm-hmm.
So Appium is a tool that you can use with both Android and iOS technologies.
Okay.
But aside from that, I wouldn't say I'm an expert with this.
Mm-hmm. Okay, cool. No worries. So you said you have a lot of experience with Spring technology and all the ecosystem, like
most of it.
Spring
yeah.
Ecosystem. Okay, would it be okay to go in that
sure.
direction? Yeah.
Sure, let's
okay.
Go.
Okay. Cool. Could you tell me what kind of modules and projects have you used from the Spring ecosystem?
Spring ecosystem is a very big one. I'm sure that's very difficult to use all of them. In most
yeah.
cases, all the projects use at least Spring Core. mm-hmm. because you need the context and the aspects and everything that's related to the core implementation.
Mm-hmm.
Then of course Spring Security, because any application or almost any application needs authentication and authorization, so you can't escape that and you don't have a lot of choices. For Spring, the best still is Spring Security. Spring Batch, in okay. some cases I had to deal with large amounts of data. Processing mm-hmm. them in batches is the best solution, and mm-hmm. Spring Batch is the, I would say, the best approach when you use Spring ecosystem, because of course you have alternatives, very good alternatives, such as Spark, for example.
Mm-hmm.
But if you use technology from the Spring family, it's always easier. So, you have better chances that you will find an answer to a question in case you have encountered the problem.
The community is bigger.
It's more helpful. Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. It's more difficult to find an answer like, how do I integrate this kind of technology external to Spring with Spring? So that's mm-hmm. why when I choose for my implementation something, if I say go with the Spring ecosystem, I try to find what I need in the Spring ecosystem, and I go outside the Spring ecosystem
mm-hmm.
when I don't find something in the Spring ecosystem. That's of course part of the Spring Cloud, like OpenFaint today is probably the
mm-hmm.
best choice to implement your client part of calling a REST endpoint in between
mm-hmm.
the services. So the REST template part, that's going to be deprecated. Now
yeah,
it's only maintenance mode. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I used Spring Reactive, but I can't say that.
Nice.
Yeah, I can't say that I used it, like I didn't implement the whole system with Spring Reactive, but
mm-hmm.
that was part of the things I've been working with. What else?
Persistence,
Spring Data, of course. Spring
okay.
Data,
Spring
mostly.
Spring Data JPA or
yeah,
something
else. Yeah, that's what I wanted to say. It's mostly Spring Data JPA, Spring Data JDBC, and Spring Data Mongo.
Mm-hmm. Okay, cool. Let's go with Spring Data JPA. What kind of ORM implementation have you used?
So in case of JPA, let's take JPA from the beginning without going into Spring. JPA is a specification and it has multiple implementations.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Hibernate is what I've mostly used.
Okay.
In the past, I've used Eclipse Link as well.
Mm-hmm.
I can't say I've seen a big difference between them, but simply due to the fact that now when implementing something with Spring, if you use Spring Boot, which by the way I forgot to enumerate,
mm-hmm.
You have out of the box the configuration that Spring Boot gives you. And of course you can override it, but I didn't see anyone overriding Hibernate.
Mm-hmm.
So in most cases now you say you start a Spring Boot project and you use JPA, you will get Hibernate as an implementation and
mm-hmm.
you usually don't change it. So that's why
mm-hmm.
most likely I used Hibernate more than any other implementation, any other JPA implementation.
Mm-hmm.
That's for one thing. I can't say I used Hibernate as a JPA implementation individually in an app without Spring. Like the entity manager factory directly
mm-hmm.
taking the persistence XML file or creating the persistent unit class, taking the entity manager, managing
mm-hmm.
all the actions.
Really low level.
Like, no, I won't say low level, because when you think at low level, I'm thinking at prepare statement, result
okay.
set.
So that's not that
low level
okay.
as much as Hibernate can go low level.
Mm-hmm.
But yes, I also did that, and of course in the past projects, say past couple of years or even more than that, I've been using only Spring Data JPA.
Mm-hmm.
In Spring Data JPA, you don't very often manage the entity manager yourself.
Mm-hmm.
I had to do that at some point for I don't even remember exactly why they have to use that precisely, but it was like something that I couldn't do with the Spring Data itself, so I had to use the entity manager to get the job done, which is pretty easy.
Something.
No, it's pretty easy. You actually just inject it. So you say entity
mm-hmm.
manager persistent context, and you
yeah,
get
yeah.
the entity manager behind the scenes. I even now had to do something even more low level than that, where I need to get a connection out of the pool directly.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it even happens. Like,
okay.
for example, canceling a statement. So even today, I don't think, or I didn't find a way to cancel a statement, like if you call a procedure on the database, how do you cancel it using Spring Data JPA. Calling it, it's easy. You have the add procedure annotation, you put it over the method, you have get the parameter and you call it.
So this was a business requirement to be able to cancel
specific process.
That was
For that, it was only possible by taking the connection from the pool and calling the procedure using the connection, so you can then call the cancellation. Of course, an idea would have also been to contribute to the Spring and implement that because it's open source, but that anyway couldn't have been done, at least by me at that time, because I had a very short limited time to implement that, so I couldn't have waited for a Spring version to do that, so I had to go low level for this.
One of my favorite questions to ask during an interview like this, have you encountered any performance issues while using Hibernate that are related to the Hibernate?
To Hibernate?
Yeah.
Okay, yes, I have encountered, and that's because in many cases it seems that Hibernate is not necessarily correctly used. And that can lead to problems. So we all know Hibernate is an excellent framework. Its pitfall is that it's also difficult to learn properly and to use properly. At the beginning, it might seem very simple. You create some entities, you call some methods, they instantaneously
do something. A lot of magic behind the scenes.
But at some point, you can make mistakes, and some of them transform into performance problems. And I think the most encountered such problem is the n plus one query problem, where you have you call a query, you have an entity with some relationships, and whenever the framework cannot create a query where it gets all the data up front, what Hibernate will do is it will send the first query to get what data it can get, and then it will call subsequent queries to get for each row of the first data the supplementary information that is needed, and that's called the n plus one query problem, because you have a first query and then another n query, so n plus one. The problem is that it's something you wish to avoid usually, because if you have, say, you get first query returns 200 rows or even more, and then you have one other query for each row, you have 201 queries to get some data. There are different ways to avoid that, but it also happens a lot, and sometimes the problem is that it's very difficult to find out that you have this problem. In a test environment, you might test with a small amount of data, so you test with 10 records and
so you
see everything is fine,
slowness.
You don't see the slowness at all. And then you deliver it, and when it gets into production, you see that you have a big problem.
And how do you approach this situation?
What I do recommend, and what we do in our team, is using a profiler every time at the end of an implementation. And we just sample the JDBC queries. It takes 5 minutes, literally. So you start Visual VM on local environment, Visual VM, press the button, execute the actions. You anyway have to test them, and then you can see in Visual VM how many queries, and if you see that at some point you have multiple duplicated queries, you know it's a problem.
It's
a red flag. Yeah.
Okay. Have you used the transactionality features of Spring with Hibernate?
You can't avoid it, can you?
you
can't have. You can't have applications without transactions, at least not with a relational database.
Exactly.
But
you know, nowadays even with Mongo,
you have transactions. I know. But anyway, you can't escape the transactional annotation.
Could you explain in short how does it work, your own transactional?
Like many other adaptations in Spring, they have an aspect behind the scenes. So so Spring provides this this aspect that intercepts the methods, intercepts the methods annotated with a transaction, and then starts a transaction or uses a specific transaction already defined depending on how you configure, on how you use that transaction. At the very end, it either commits or rollbacks the transaction, again, depending on what happens.
Have you used any extra configuration, let's say, for the transactional, like isolation levels?
At some point I needed that, even though I do usually recommend and prefer to stay as simple as possible. So if I can avoid using the propagation level, isolation level, rollback for, no rollback for, and other attributes that customize some specific feature, I do that. But in some cases you can't avoid it. Like in case of isolation level, say you have to execute something that has to be seen from outside the transaction. The default for transactional is the read committed isolation level, and that means that from outside that transaction, the data will only be seen after the commit. If you need data to be seen even before the commit, then you necessarily need to go with a lower isolation level.
Okay, have you any experience in let's say in advanced programming directly on the database, let's say writing functions or procedures or triggers directly on the database?
I did that and I do that, but as a normal simple Java developer, not as a database expert, because there are a lot of things to take into consideration there. And I can't say that I know all the best practices about writing procedures, functions, triggers and stuff like that. In many cases where I used, for example, triggers was to simply find out for debugging purposes, not necessarily for an implementation. So I needed to find out where a specific update was called, and I used the trigger for that. I'm not even sure if I would complicate my code using triggers, for example, on specific updates, but of course it maybe depends again on what we implement. But I can say I know how to use it, I used it, but as a Java developer, not as a database expert.
Okay, cool. Okay, thank you. Is it okay for you to continue with some Java fundamentals?
Of course.
Okay, cool. What version of Java are you currently using on your project slash project?
Happen to be one of the happiest using Java 17, which is the latest version and the latest long-term support version.
Okay, that's really cool. Could you give me some examples of a recent implementation in Java? Like, not necessarily in Java 17, but let's say from Java
11 up to 17, which is 11 was the long-term
supported
version, and that's what I've been using before Java 17. I do use, and we do use now a lot in our project. I think the developers in our team love to use the text blocks. That's because the application we have defines a lot of queries. Some of them are JPQL. We also have some other services using JDBC. We don't use directly JDBC, we use Spring Data JDBC, but you still have to write the queries. In tutorials, queries are usually very, very small, but in real world, they tend to become bigger. 10 lines, 15 lines of code, you have multiple joins, unions, so on and so forth. And the best thing is that you can simply copy paste it now, so that's something we love. Prior to text blocks, we had to concatenate and have it on multiple lines. IntelliJ does that, and most IDEs, Eclipse, I think the same, does
that.
But when you have to copy it from there, then you have to take out all that plus and quotes. It takes you a lot of time, and you lose 5 minutes for nothing. Now you simply copy it. Our developers and I liked very much the enhancements in the switch. I think in the past, at least, a lot of mistakes were done because developers were forgetting to add that break at the end of the case. It was the fact that you had to write case one under the other every time you had to apply some logic for multiple values. Now you can simply separate them by comma. The syntax is much shorter and easier to read, and that's of course better because we can say you have a cleaner code. Other things that have appeared are the record classes. We didn't use that up to now. I use them only in testing it to for myself, but
for learning
we are still using Lombok. So anyway, records, they are by definition immutable. You can't use them because of that with Hibernate. So entities, you can't do entities with record classes. On the entity side, to get rid of the getters and setters, you still have to use Lombok or something similar. So we didn't have the chance. For DTOs, maybe it would be applicable, but since all our application is now with Lombok and we already have a lot of things defined, we don't really like to mix syntaxes because, again, we find that it affects the maintainability. So instead of having some of them records and some of them classes, and since we don't have the time to change all of them, we prefer to continue with classes. So that's why we didn't use records up to now.
Okay. Like to have a consistent and easy to understand code.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. Anything else? Have you used the modules?
So modules, they appeared in Java 9.
Yeah.
I couldn't say I used them like myself. I didn't program something with modules. But what I do recommend, so when I worked as a consultant for a specific team, I do recommend using modules, especially when designing libraries. And the best thing about modules when designing a library is that you can specify explicitly what exactly from a module can be consumed from outside. And that's something that we were really missing in the libraries previously. And we are still missing in some of them, which are not modular. Because when you take a library, say you've never seen it. I had to use specific libraries sometimes I've never seen. Like libraries, totally corner case libraries connecting to a specific device or something like that. That's something you don't find a lot of documentation on online if you search for it. It's not like when searching Spring on Stack Overflow. So what happened is that I had an API, of course, and I had a documentation for that. But it's still difficult if you have a bunch of code, like many classes, and you can access all of them.
And you have to navigate through all
them. Imagine how much simpler it is if they only expose those three classes that you have to use.
Like they give you a hint.
They give you a big hint. These are what you need to focus on. Yeah. You know where to start from. It's much better. And that's what you can do with modules. And that's why modules, the module system appeared with Java 9 is really important. Maybe some of the viewers don't even know that when they design a module, they can even design a module to expose only for some other module. So that's how, for example, you can implement something like a module, communicate with another module in your own library, but don't share it outside. So you can still share outside only precisely what someone using the
library. Fine grained control over the
for the maintainability point of view on using that specific library, it's a great improvement.
Okay.
And of course, even if we don't know, we are using modules every day when working with Java 9 and above because the JDK is modular. So now you don't need to use all the modules. In Java 8, you have a JDK which is monolithical. It has a jar, it's called the RT jar. It has some 50-60 megabytes. And you have to use it. Whatever application you implement, you have to use all of it. Do you use some specific technology? Like, do you use Swing, which is something you can implement desktop apps with, which is very old, by the way. Even if you use it or not and you have a server-side application, you have to have Swing there in your app. You can't escape it. With a modular JDK, you use only the modules that you really need. So you can avoid needing to use...
Having a big footprint of your application.
A big footprint, yeah, exactly.
Yeah. And this is very relevant if you think about
containers, cloud, microservices, spinning them fast. That's really relevant.
Okay, cool. One last topic I would like to discuss is threads.
Okay.
And concurrency problems.
Okay.
you are smiling, so I guess you have some history.
Yeah, I have some history with that. Okay. Today is not that you use threads and concurrency a lot anymore. A lot of magic happens behind the scenes. Not directly, yeah. Mm-hmm. A lot of magic happens behind the scenes when you use like an application. Mm-hmm. Even when you use a reactive application that has a lot of threading behind the scenes. Mm-hmm. And the stuff that is not necessarily easy to implement and understand, you still use it like it's somewhere inside the box you don't see it. But in the past, yes, I had to implement at some point my multi-thread architectures, which is not something easy. And of course, the biggest problems you can get into are deadlocks, mm-hmm. which are simple to understand. The problem is simple to understand. It's much more difficult to solve in the real world. Mm-hmm.
What kind of skills do you think you need? What kind of skills you used?
Profiling for investigating locks and analyzing thread dumps. Usually when you get a problem from a production environment, you will get a thread dump, which is a picture of how the threads look like, mm-hmm. when the application was stuck.
Okay.
So analyzing thread dumps is mandatory.
Mm-hmm.
You basically have no other option. Usually profiling remotely is not that easy because of restrictions you have with
mm-hmm. security environments.
Okay. That's the way you load the thread dump that you generated in that specific location, and then you have to analyze all the threads, their statuses, who is waiting for what lock, and then try to figure out why they got into that situation.
Okay, thank you. And again, something else popped up in my mind. Because of course I told you I'm also thinking about your role as a team lead, like as a senior member of a team who should also coach and mentor and help upskill the other team members. How do you approach the code review process?
The code review process?
Yeah. How do you do code review?
So first of all, what I do recommend is everyone should review the code. So it's mm-hmm. I never support an approach where you have one senior guy or more seniors reviewing the code for each other and for the juniors.
And only them.
Yes, mm-hmm. I do support having usually, if possible, a couple at least of reviewers for every commit. So
okay.
It depends on the team, because if you have a team of four, you might not be able to have a couple of reviewers for every commit, because if two of them are in vacation, then you are stuck.
Mm-hmm.
But for a larger team, for example, two code reviews would be the best.
Mm-hmm.
And what I always recommend is juniors as well as seniors, they should code review a commit. And preferably, if I have two code reviews, it will be one junior and one senior, to make sure that if there are two juniors, they might miss things, but
mm-hmm.
if you have a senior and a junior, they will find everything. And the reason why I want always junior people to also code review is because that's one good point where they can learn.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not necessarily that they will say find something, but they will learn from reading the other's code,
mm-hmm.
ask some questions themselves, why did they do that, stuff like that. And then maybe even apply that in one of the next implementations they do.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, we don't have to underestimate them. Juniors still might have a fresher mind than us, so they sometimes find things because they are less tired at some point. You have to be honest, senior developers sometimes get very tired because of not only the development they do, but also other things, discussions, administrative management stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Usually juniors, they don't do that, so they only work on code, so they have fresh minds.
Mm-hmm.
And they can see the errors faster,
mm-hmm.
even in some cases.
In short, could you tell me what principles or what best practices do you always follow? So like the, let's see, top three, top five.
Yes, I definitely rely first on the known principles for writing clean code, solid, dry, kiss, Yagni.
Okay.
You have to know this. It's not easy to apply them from the very beginning. When you say I'm learning solid now and next line of code is designed
solid.
According to solid, yeah, that's not what will happen. But with time, if you train your mind to have these principles in to have them somewhere there and think about them, then you will write progressively better code. But the easiest is to start with the simplest code smells. So just start from, I don't want to have a method that is larger than a screen. I don't say five lines of code because I know that's the cliche seen everywhere in a lot of books, starting from the Robert C. Martin book to other books, five lines of code. It's not from
it's
my perspective.
Dream.
Yeah, it's a dream and it's not necessarily the best thing that you can go to. So I don't say five lines of code, but my metric is I want, if I have a method, I want to see it in a screen. Why? Because I don't want to scroll up and down. So I find it easy to read as long as I don't have to scroll. Same on the horizontal. The number of parameters, usually a large number of parameters means you have too many dependencies. You minimize the number of parameters, both for constructors and for methods. Number of fields in a class. The more fields, and that's not for DTOs or entities, I refer specifically here to services. The more fields you have in a service, the more, and it means that you have multiple responsibilities that you might want to split apart. So a service might have 1, 2, 3 repositories, maybe use a manager to remove some code application, but that's it. You go and you still continue having 10-15 lines of code with fields declarations. It means you have multiple responsibilities, which at some point they might get into a god object and make the things more difficult to understand, and at some point even more difficult to refactor. So that's what I'm always thinking about, at least the minimum code smells. Names of methods, names of variables, make them easy to read in general. And having always in mind these solid principles, dry kiss, Yagni, as well, it's never going to be you write some code and it's clean from the very beginning. It will always be iteratively upgraded. Boy Scout rule is what we call it. We iteratively, if we find something that we can improve, we improve it. And of course, by writing tests, somehow you also make yourself write a better code, because you can't write a unit test properly or an integration test if you have a large method. So that will hurt. When you have to write a test, it will hurt just because you have a large method. So you will think about, let's split this method now because otherwise I can't write a test. So that's another point why unit tests are good.
One question from the audience. I think it will be the last one. How do you approach on understanding and refactoring old legacy huge undocumented enterprise code base and direct your junior engineers as a team lead?
Okay, let me read it myself. It was a quite long one. So how do you approach on understanding and refactoring old legacy huge undocumented enterprise? Very difficult. It's a very painful process to refactor. First of all, there are many reasons why this is painful. First of all, it might take a long time. So when you plan refactoring, you have a huge code base, messy, like a monolithic old application 20 years ago made when there were no principles at all. And I've been through that at some point, and that's quite difficult to tackle. First of all, you cannot make it all at once. So you have to think in a way in which you can progressively release, iteratively release stuff. which is not necessarily easy because sometimes there are things that you can't, you need to release at once, at the same time. And imagine even more than that you have, because that was a point of trouble we had at some point when we have been refactoring such of a kind of an application. We wanted to get it into service-oriented. Again, I don't say microservices, service-oriented. Okay. But the idea was that developers working on that application, they at the same time, other developers, they had to improve the application with new business requirements. So other developers were working, adding code to the application while we're trying to refactor it, split it up. So you had to somehow merge the code they were written and do the refactoring at once,
because
which is really difficult.
You don't afford to have a separate team concentrating only on
you don't afford the stop, an entire stop of the development for not even weeks sometimes, not even days sometimes. So that's the best, the biggest problem is how you do that. And you see, there is no recipe for that. There are multiple books out there, like Monolith to Microservices from Sam Neumann, very good book. But the only thing it can give you, and the only thing books can give you in this direction, is advices. But there is no recipe, like this is how you should do it when you have. Because it always depends precisely on that application.
How would you guide the junior members of your team in this process? What advice would you give them?
So first of all, the junior members, they should follow the principles that we discussed earlier when working.
They should know them.
They should know them up front. So you should train them to know them and use them, because if they have to implement something new and they have a method with already 20 parameters and they only add one more parameter, that's not gonna help. So you just have to train them, know that, and then when they are into such a situation, they will have to lose more time, but they will have to also find a way to
refactor bit by bit what code
So instead of adding one more parameter, which takes maybe 2 hours, they will have to spend 1 week to refactor whatever already exists.
Would you take time from your team to have, let's say, workshops or technical meetings with your junior members?
We do actually, and I always did that.
Okay.
And even in the current team, we allocate at least 30 minutes per week, even more if it's needed. Usually it's not, but the idea is that we have, say, a team of 8 people. They do implement different things. I'm usually aware of everything that they implement, but they are not aware, or at least not much aware, of what the others do, especially in today's conditions when we all of us work online. So we are no longer in the same room like we were before, where we can discuss, go to lunch together and stuff like that. And that was very difficult. And one of the ways we do that is, for the application itself we are implementing, have that at least 30 minutes per week. We put the points up front that we want to discuss regarding implementations. We don't have to discuss everything, just the important stuff, like I implemented this kind of WebSockets mechanism, or I implemented some role-based stuff here.
So really interesting technical
and
stuff.
Technical stuff especially.
And share with the team.
Exactly, and then they learn it this way. And then, of course, sometimes if some developer says, I implemented this security mechanism, it doesn't necessarily mean that in 10 minutes where you present they already learned that, but then they can go further and read something about that technology. So it's also part of their duty that they have to allocate some time to learn. And we do allow all developers actually to allocate some time weekly for learning purposes. So to learn better, especially what others did, because what you did, you already know somehow, you investigated, but what others did, that's where they need the time for.
Okay, cool. Thank you very much. I think I will rest my case. So I will prepare a technical feedback report. I will share it to our recruitment team and they will contact you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank
so
you
I'm looking
much.
Forward to your answer for this interview. Guys, I think that was it. We don't want to get you bored, of course. We only spared a little bit more than 1 hour. And the reason is, of course, we can't spend the same as we would do in a normal technical interview. A normal technical interview might take a couple of hours, even more, depending on the seniority of the interviewee. Mm-hmm. And the job, but we can't do that now. It wouldn't make sense. You will simply get bored. But what I hope is that you found out a lot of interesting stuff. So like what an interview, how an interview goes, which are kinds of questions that are asked for this kind of position. One thing to remember is that it always depends on the role. So you need to carefully know upfront to what kind of position you apply. There are different kinds of positions even for Java developers. Say if someone would have wanted me for a role with big data in Hadoop, then I would definitely not be the appropriate person for that role. So I don't go to that interview just because I don't know the stuff that they will ask me. So an interview can always go different depending on what the requirements are for the role. And of course, what you have observed is that the discussion didn't necessarily go into detail. So usually an interviewer doesn't ask, or at least a good interviewer doesn't ask stuff like, I don't know, what does a specific parameter of a specific method do? Or how many parameters does that specific method in the JDK have? Because these are what we call trivia questions. So yeah. Trivia questions don't tell you necessarily that the specific folk know or don't know what they need. You might not know, for example, that the at.wired annotation have a required parameter just because you never used it, just because in the end it's not even a best practice to use it. But that doesn't mean you are not a good Spring developer. So that's the idea. So that's why an interviewer usually doesn't ask these kind of questions. And it's a difficult stuff to be an interviewer, actually, because you only have usually maybe at most a couple of hours. And then in those couple of hours, you need to ask the right questions to find out if that specific interviewee is appropriate for the position you're looking for. Mm-hmm. So I see there are a lot of other questions in the chat. Of course we will not have the time to answer all of those, but if you are really interested in them, then leave me some messages, please, on LinkedIn and Twitter as well, and even here on YouTube in the comment section. And maybe in the future I will try to make separate session for these questions. So too many of you, thank you very much actually for being so many with us today. And that's a good sign, actually. Hopefully I will be able to answer those questions if you find me, and we can discuss them separately. Thank you very much, everyone. Until next time, have an excellent time for study. Cheers.
Bye.
Yay! Cât a durat?